Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am Keisha, a PhD student from the School of Public Health, and it is my honour to welcome you to a panel discussion on a topic that has been gaining traction here in recent months. So a very good morning and welcome to today's Public Health Thought and Leadership Dialogue presented by the Leadership Institute of Global Health Transformation, LITE, at the Swee Hock School of Public Health. Today's topic is on driving Singapore's war on diabetes, and I would like to now welcome the Dean of the Swee Hock School of Public Health, Professor Chia Kee Seng, up on stage to introduce today's topic and the panelists for today's session. Professor Chia.
Well, morning everyone, and welcome to this Public Health Thought Leadership Dialogue organized by the Leadership Institute of Global Health Transformation, LITE for short. The aim of this dialogue is to promote academic-governmental interactions on global health issues that are relevant both to Singapore as well as in the region. One of the things that LITE does, apart from the dialogue, is also to host visiting professors who can contribute to the production of global health white papers for both local as well as regional audience. And today I'm happy to actually launch and announce the launch of our first white paper, Today's Challenges in Outbreak Preparedness, the Role of Surveillance. This was the product of an earlier dialogue with Professor Peter Piot from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, as well as subsequently the visiting professor, David Heyman, to help us to craft this particular paper. We will be sending this to our alumni as well as to regional academic and governmental public health institutions. So today is World Diabetes Day, and as you know, Singapore has a war on diabetes, and to capture the minds of the general population, MOH has come up with the tagline, let's beat diabetes. The graphics for the alphabets B, E, and A are quite straightforward. B has blood, so be aware. You know, E, eat rightly, you have a carrot, you have a banana. A for being physically active. But T looks like a Indian lampshade, you know, during Deepavali. But if you look carefully, T actually is 2 feet on the weighing scale. If you've forgotten everything, at least you learned this one thing today. Now, MOH has also launched a 6-month public engagement exercise to gather feedback and ideas in the development of a diabetes action plan. I hope this morning session will also contribute to the development of this diabetes action plan. If you have seen today's Straits Times, it reported that about 1,600 have shared their ideas. We have about 300 people here. After today, MOH can report nearly 2,000 people have contributed. But seriously, we'll be summarizing today's dialogue as well as comments and questions and discussions from you. And we'll be submitting that as a report to MOH as part of our contributions from the academic sector. Now, the task force from MOH has also come up with a strategic framework, and this is the framework that has been presented. And this morning, we will make use of this framework to structure our dialogue around the three key pillars: prevention, screening, and control of diabetes. Now, to allow everyone to speak freely, I'm going to enforce the Chatham House rules, which means that anyone here can use information expressed during this dialogue, but the information cannot be attributed to any participant or any speaker, right? So if there are any members of the press in the audience, please respect this rule. Now let me introduce and invite our panel members up on stage. First, we have Professor Paul Zimmet from Monash University. Paul is a world-renowned diabetologist, and I call him a mover and shaker in the world of diabetes. He loves to say, if diabetes is a country, it will be the third largest nation in the world. So welcome, Paul, emperor of the third largest nation in the world. And Professor Kenneth Mark, DDMS, Ministry of Health, is a very, very important man in our war on diabetes because he leads the program office that supports the Diabetes Prevention and Care Task Force. So nothing goes to them except through him. Kenneth? Thirdly, Swee. Swee is a woman of power. She's an endocrinologist as well as a clinical director for our NUHS Regional Planning Office. Swee. Now, how I run this dialogue is to have the panelists comment on different segments of the So they'll comment on different segments of the three areas that we'd like to talk about. And we will have one or two questions for each of the segments, and hopefully we can cover some of this. But we'll also be opening it to the floor for you to raise any comments or you have any questions that you want to raise to the panelists. So maybe let's start off with the first segment with Paul. You were very instrumental in Australia's National Diabetes Strategy, and that strategy highlighted the need to take a population approach. What do you mean by that population approach, and why was the rationale a population approach?
Thank you very much for the invitation to be in Singapore and participate in this. I was actually co-chair of a government decision 2 years ago, Australian government decision, to develop a national diabetes strategy, which is probably the fifth one over the last 15 years, and none of them have been activated so far. I'm glad this is Chatham House rules, see, to start off with. The new strategy, which was handed to the minister a year ago, was then handed on to the Department of Health, who then sanitised it and cut out a lot of things, etc., including at the moment what we have recommended as a strategy group, and that is rather than a high-risk strategy to prevent type 2 diabetes, to enlist a population strategy. And I think that's what your question is. And I think it's a pretty simple... It's a big argument that goes on between people around the world in diabetes. And there are very clear studies in the United States, in India, in Japan, and elsewhere showing that if you take high-risk people with pre-diabetes, and put them into a program of exercise and weight reduction, you can reduce by up to about 50% progression to type 2 diabetes. Now that's lovely, we have that data now. However, if you look at the new cases of diabetes in the community, about 20% of the population, and it varies obviously, here it would be around 20% I guess, in Australia maybe 15%, are high risk subjects. They only constitute 50% of the new cases of diabetes. The other 50% come from the whole community. And I think it's pretty clear now that population-based studies not only are good for preventing type 2 diabetes, but other chronic diseases. And I think I'll just leave it there for the moment as an introductory statement, that remembering that 50% of new cases of type 2 diabetes do come from people who we would not consider at high risk, I think there's a very good rationale to undertake population-based intervention with, of course, which would include interventions in the high-risk groups.
Swee, you want to add anything?
You for the invitation to join in this very, I hope, lively discussion this morning. I wanted to caveat the point you made about power. I think we're all here today because we all have the power to make a difference. And I think that through forums like this, that's really our role, to equip ourselves with a better understanding of how we can all play a role in this. With regards to the comment about high-risk populations, I mean, I think I tend to agree with that perspective, that there probably is a separation between interventions that are lifestyle-based, which, as Paul pointed out, have the ability and the potential to really impact on not just diabetes, but really the outcomes that we care about in persons with diabetes, the heart attacks, the strokes, and the kidney problems, etc. And all these stem from the same risk factors for which lifestyle modifications can make a tremendous difference and impact. I think the difference therein lies for targeted interventions that, for example, involve drugs and pharmacotherapy. And those, perhaps, we need to refine and really use data to help guide us as to which segment of the population might benefit most from such stratification towards high-risk groups.
From our perspective, when we decided to launch the war on diabetes, we actually recognized that the interventions and strategies we adopt were not necessarily just focused and targeted only on diabetes alone. But in fact, the war on diabetes, the strategies we implement were in fact system changes that in fact would also benefit the health and the state of health of the entire population, because in many ways, diabetes has risk factors perhaps that in fact are not just risk factors for diabetes, but risk factors which are common for many other conditions and diseases as well, whether it's hypertension, coronary artery disease, atherosclerotic disease, and so on. So in fact, once we embark on a strategy to reduce the risk and incidence of diabetes, one would have necessary to tackle those risk factors, and one cannot be insular and therefore only describe these interventions as only being focused on a population that will get diabetes. These were significant interventions that in fact had to be spun over an entire population, and the global effect therefore was not just reducing the incidence of diabetes, but the trickle-on collateral effect was that you would also impact then on the risk factors for coronary artery disease, heart disease, and that in fact also had a significant benefit. The other thing to remember is that diabetes is not an individual's disease on its own. To some extent, there's a strong social element because these risk factors run in families. They run, and in order to engineer success for an individual to be empowered to take active control of his own lifestyle, in order to impact on his risk profile, we have to also remember that, in fact, there's a significant benefit to empowering a society, the peer group network that an individual is in, which helps to drive and provide ongoing motivation for an individual, therefore, to be disciplined about continuing and maintaining an active lifestyle, healthy eating choices. It is not just impacting and trying to drive a change in a single individual. That cannot take place if it's a very targeted, focused strategy only on individuals that have an identified risk for getting diabetes. It has to be, in fact, a population health-based strategy. And we have seen, in fact, in many countries where such population-wide strategies do shift the needle, but you shift the needle by, in fact, improving the state of health of an entire population through shifting the entire curve. We visited Finland very recently, and we looked at them. In fact, their success was not just in the context of a diabetes program. Their NUHS project which aimed at trying to improve the state of health primarily for a single state initially, where it was noted to have high incidences of myocardial infarcts. And their choice was not to then target strategies that only were hitting that particular state, but to impact on the entire country when it came to healthy eating choices, reducing the risk for getting atherosclerosis. And the state of health then for that state therefore improved with lowering the incidences of coronary artery disease, but the entire society benefited as well. So from that point of view, a population-based strategy makes sense and should continue to underpin all our efforts when it comes to prevention of diabetes. But it's not unreasonable to accept that when we can identify risk factors that now allow us to identify a high-risk population, there should be complementary strategies that may allow us to provide a greater emphasis of effort on that group. But it should not be positioned as a mutually exclusive set of interventions that either I deal with a population health strategy or a focus strategy, and never the twain shall meet. Because I think there may be, in fact, complementary roles for both to take place.
No, I agree completely. Seeing we're under Chatham House rules, I have to tell you that despite the fact our national government advisory group have recommended a community-based approach to preventing diabetes, in my own state of Victoria, the government, which had a wonderful program, the Healthy Together Victoria program, dropped the program funding and have used the money to focus on high-risk individuals, which, of course, is a political thing pushed by the local diabetes group. When I'd been advising the state government all the time that the high-risk money should be spent on the community. There are clearly high-risk individuals which we have to focus on, as Kenneth has said, within a community strategy. And I think an area would be very interesting to discuss, I think, is the issue of gestational diabetes, which I believe is something like 20% or more of pregnancies here in Singapore, and we see that in the Chinese community in Australia. And there is a saying which I like very much, and that is, diabetes begets diabetes. And I suspect people here in Singapore in the health professional area know more about this concept than anyone in the world elsewhere now because of the GUSTO study, which is an amazing study. I think it's one of the first studies internationally looking at the impact of behaviours during pregnancy. Now, while the focus is on women and alcohol, cigarette smoking, high blood sugar in terms of diabetes in pregnancy, and even malnutrition. And I've been accused actually of being sexist because we're always talking about maternal and child health being important. There are data emerging now that actually preconception, if a male is overweight or engaging in these health behaviours, they actually can have an impact on the baby that's born and the epigenetic changes which can lead to high risk of chronic disease in later life. So I think that while we're talking about community strategies, etc., we do have to emphasise, as Kenneth has said, that the high-risk people do require special attention. We have number one in the world here today in geriatric diabetes, a geriatrician, Professor Jeffrey Horder, who may make a comment later on, in interventions in the elderly. I think that's a very important area as we're all getting older. And another thing that we should be thinking about, and it may relate back to GUSTO and the outcomes from GUSTO, is that when he did medicine like 40 years ago, type 2 diabetes was a disorder of people over the age of 60. You know? Now we're seeing it in the working group, so it's got workforce implications, socioeconomic implications for government productivity, and in our indigenous community in Australia, we are seeing type 2 diabetes in 8-year-old children now. I was just in Malaysia 3 or 4 weeks ago, and they're becoming very concerned about young onset type 2 diabetes. So these are all factors I think we ought to be discussing when we're talking about the community approach.
I just wanted to expound on that a little bit and say that if we think about what are high-risk groups, so if we're clear about what we mean persons with a history of gestational diabetes, those who are overweight or obese, and remember in our population, it's not obese. You know, being overweight, the metabolic complications set in at relatively lower levels of obesity. And traditionally, we say, you know, those who are obese, that's a third category, and of course, the first degree relatives of those with type 2 diabetes. And you've just heard gestational diabetes, 20%. Prevalence of diabetes in our population, right, on average, about 13%. In the US, where the obesity rates are over 30%, prevalence is 8.7%. So it's disproportionately higher in our in populations such as ours. And so what then becomes a high-risk group necessarily becomes a very, very large number of people. So I think the point that Kenneth made about how the approaches necessarily, and particularly in a population like ours, must be complementary definitely holds, because the approaches towards, you know, all that you've heard about, beat diabetes, advocating for healthier lifestyles, will apply to all of us, I think, whether or not we fall today in that high-risk group, because at some point we probably will, or our children will. But then perhaps in the high-risk group, it is about increasing awareness so that those that are not picked up currently do feel more compelled to want to do something and step forward to be screened, and perhaps the intensity of surveillance thereafter once you're in a high-risk group.
Yeah, I mean, that reminds me when I was doing my MPH, my professor of public health taught me that the difference between a population-based approach and a high-risk group approach is that you take a population-based approach, if the number of people who became, has the outcome with small degree of exposure, will end up with larger numbers compared to that of the high-risk group, right? And secondly, that there is a dose-response relationship. In other words, it's not a kind of a threshold effect where the risk only increases if you hit certain threshold. And for the case of diabetes, definitely from our own local data, there is no threshold. The very fact that we are overweight, we are already at increased risk of diabetes. So you mentioned this specific high risk group, those with family history, those with gestational diabetes, and those women with gestational diabetes are at higher risk. Are there any other high risk groups, you know, in Singapore? Is ethnic group, for example, high-risk groups?
There's obviously one of the long arguments in diabetes has been the question of whether people of European extraction are less likely to get diabetes as opposed to... And people use the term Caucasians, forgetting that I think Caucasians are Mongolians and Indians and everything. So it's... the wrong term in any case. So we talk about European extraction. So there does appear to be some ethnic variation, but there are obviously social and economic reasons. But talking about other high-risk groups, there are comorbidities associated with type 2 diabetes, such as depression and sleep apnea. And we know both of those groups are more likely to get diabetes. Maybe the people with depression, obviously some of the drugs that are used cause obesity and can cause diabetes, but there seems to be some link there. And certainly people with sleep apnea or sleep disturbances are more likely to get diabetes. And something that people have told me here in Singapore is that people in Singapore work the longest hours and the hardest of anyone else in the world. And it's quite clear that people on shift work have got high risk of getting diabetes and obesity. So this may have something to do with disturbance of body clock and circadian rhythm, the association of diabetes, depression, and sleep apnea. But so you've got a very high risk group just in the workforce alone. And I think we have to spend a lot more time understanding how we live and how that itself, and it's not talked very much, as being actually a major factor.
Kenneth?
Well, certainly in terms of the risk that you've mentioned, Paul, we do agree that, in fact, there are many different factors that would influence one's risk profile. You talked about sleep, but certainly many Singaporeans are sleep deprived. And there are studies that suggest a association with lack of sleep and the increased incidence of diabetes. But it's not just a lack of sleep issue. There are studies also that suggest too much sleep can also be associated with increase. And if you look at it, it's simply because there are many attributes to sleep disorders in it. Yeah. Yeah. But it perhaps underpins a point that in fact often causation is difficult to identify, and we can attribute perhaps multiple risk factors that interplay, and then when that occurs, then that in fact affects your risk profile. Too much sleep may be an indicator for a sedentary lifestyle that in itself may be associated with obesity and other issues. So there's a significant confounding effect that sometimes makes it very difficult for us to be very definitive about identifying any particular individual factor as causative. But I'm not sure whether we want to be trapped in an argument or conversation that says because of the lack of evidence to suggest that strong causative effect, we should therefore not even highlight these as possible contributions to one's risk profile. And it still is in keeping with a message that we want all of our population to adopt a healthy lifestyle in terms of adequate sleep, good nutrition, healthy eating, active lifestyles. And therefore, it's not unreasonable that we should still mention these, even though the association may not be as strong as we would like in terms of playing up causation. But if we want to look at elephants in the room, when we look at other factors, which I think Kee Seng was bringing up, we do see that, in fact, several ethnic groups in Singapore where there is an increased prevalence and incidence. There's no dodging that. We do see this, whether it's in the Indian and Malay population. It is not something perhaps we need to hide away from, but we need to confront that, in fact, there are some ethnic groups where there's scope for us to look carefully and identify whether, in fact, they have a higher risk profile. But those risk profiles may not necessarily be completely epigenetic. They may be, in fact, again, that interplay of various factors, including social economic status, including diet, which is a cultural influence. And these in themselves may also be contributing to one's risk for getting diabetes, but showing up as an increased prevalence in certain ethnic groups, whether in the Malay or Indian subpopulation. When we look at our data, looking at housing types, correlating that also to the risk profile for getting diabetes, we do know that in fact those who are actually staying in the rented flats, for example, or those with your one-room flats and so on, they may reflect a certain strata in our social economic system, but they certainly do have a different risk profile or prevalence for getting diabetes as opposed to others. But this again may be a function less of social economic status, but also whether or not they are also engaging in unhealthy habits. Whether it's in terms of eating, they may be spending a lot more time at work, and therefore time commitment to exercise is also a problem for them. So it's difficult sometimes to detangle these factors and try to identify which is the main causal factor that's actually contributing to one's risk profile. My suspicion is it's a complex interplay of various factors, and it's sometimes fruitless for us to really engage in a discussion about which individual factor therefore will give us greatest bang for buck in terms of sometimes trying to influence behavior. But we do have to look at a whole basket of activities that have to be engaged in.
I'll just add one other important factor, which is age. I mean, increasing age is one of the strongest risk factors. And in our context, the aging population is just going to really swell. And so the burden of chronic diseases such as diabetes will be commensurate with that. I think studies such as Gusto that Paul highlighted, and there are the ongoing studies that really try and look at upstream and then follow the progression Even in studies like that, I think they offer the opportunity to really understand as complex as those contributing factors are there opportunities to tease out specific things? So even when it comes to social factors, access to foods, food choices, are there differences between groups? Can anything be done to potentially influence accessibility and food choices, impact of different types of physical activity? I think there's no, it's a lifestyle disease. So really culturally, we also need to understand what are the different factors that resonate with different people. And ultimately, I think if we're really going to make an impact on this war, we really need to not just do the rocket science and understand the biology, but also understand various other psychological and social factors.
We've been very person-centric so far, I think, in relation to this. And again, I'm glad it's Chatham House rules, so I won't get thrown out of Singapore too quickly. But my observation, actually, over the last couple of years is that there's a lot of publicity and movement about diabetes, the war on diabetes, the healthy lifestyle, and taxi cabs going around now with beat diabetes in it. One of the problems in intervening and community interventions is role of government and what their commitment is. And there is a trend of many governments to push it back, say we're not a nanny state, and they push it back onto individuals to enact things. Now, the question is, in Singapore, there's a lot, front page of the Straits Times today, a couple of weeks ago, war on diabetes on page two, et cetera, et cetera. Is the government, is it a superficial intervention so far in terms of a lot of publicity and noise? Is this being translated actually into action into the community? So you were probably going to ask that question in a way, but I mean, that's one of my observations, I guess, looking at the Singapore situation over many years, because I think it was like about 15 years ago I was here to help design the first national diabetes study with the health department.
Yeah, I think just to protect you from being thrown out and prevented from coming back to Singapore, I think these are still early days. And I think we are at the phase whereby we recognize that in the war on diabetes, firstly, it is not a simple single factor that we're targeting at. Secondly, it is not; it cannot be a top-down approach, unlike, say, for example, perhaps smoking. Thirdly, that there must be buy-in not just from the general population, buy-in also from various private sectors, players, as well as even the whole public sector. So I think these are early days. Whether it's too little, too late, whether it's an uphill battle that we will not win, that only time will tell. But in my view, I think these are really very early days.
One of the problems with using the term war on diabetes is that with the experience with military conflicts, it's actually very difficult to talk about war and talk about victory and talking about ending a conflict when it comes to talking about a health problem that, in fact, is which is incurable, so to speak. With the exception, I know Asim is in the audience, with the exception perhaps of some patients who may go for bariatric surgery, it doesn't necessarily influence the risk profile for getting complications following on after getting diabetes as well. But I think what is important perhaps is to bring it home that when we do form a national strategy, when we form a task force overseeing, helping to plan that strategy, what is important is not the advertising, the PR events that may kick off an event to just raise the profile and publicity and attention. What is more important is how to keep actually that strategy sustainable. And in fact, it's the multi-year effort that's actually more important than necessarily what you actually do in the first few months of a campaign. And there's been quite a bit of time, attention. Kee Seng knows this because he's actually a member of the task force at national level. where questions are being asked. It's nice, it's sexy to organize a television and advertising campaign, but one needs to go beyond that superficial surface and actually identify the interventions that are sustaining, that must be put in place, and they would be now multi-year efforts, ongoing efforts, that now continue to work despite perhaps the war on diabetes label passing, that in fact then impact on the population health over years. One of the important lessons we've learned very early on is to also appreciate that there's a long latency effect between whatever interventions and strategies we put in place and actually seeing to fruition a drop in the incidence and prevalence of diabetes. It will not happen overnight. And therefore, it's important to bring home even to our population the message that we're in it for the long haul. We're not in it just for superficial points gained that may influence any particular government's image in the eyes of the public. And we certainly are not working on it from one election to another when it comes to important strategies like this that underpin the health of the entire nation. There was a point that perhaps resonated with me when Swee was talking about risk factors and was talking about this issue with age. And we had previously also been talking about obesity. And I mentioned this issue with long latency effects. You know, when we're now seeing an important public health problem in Singapore, we're seeing high incidences. I've had a conversation with Kee Seng, and just perhaps resurrecting part of that discussion I've had with you before. Are we seeing a lot of the effect now related to age? While we talk about obesity, have we actually seen the impact of obesity coming in? Because this is an important message that we also want to bring across to the public. If we are still in the midst of a latency effect from what we are seeing with our changing profile as far as obesity is concerned, in fact, we will continue to see rises in prevalence and incidence of diabetes despite interventions and strategies that we're putting into effect. We're going to talk about to the public about health, healthy eating choices. We may be talking about how we want to encourage better nutritional choices we made, active lifestyle, and so on. But the traction that we have in engaging these activities may not come for at least even another decade. So therefore, we will now see an ongoing increase in the prevalence rates that will take place over the next 2 years, and it may be in part due to that latency effect as a result of the increased rates of obesity in our population. And therefore, it's important that as we educate the public about these campaigns that we're actually going out to, we need also to temper the expectations of our public to help them to understand that these are long-term campaigns. The effect, the sum total of benefit is not seen in the here and now. It's not even seen in the months to the few years, but it'll be seen decades later. And they should not necessarily see, therefore, a short-term increase in prevalence rate as failure of the public health campaigns that we're engaging in. It's an important parallel message that sometimes needs to be given, and it's a hard one for us to give, because if we're trying to push people to the correct behavior, it seems at odds that we're also telling the public, hey, while I'm asking you to do this, you won't see the benefit until much later, but you see things getting worse temporarily in the short term. But it's important, I think, that we also need to have that understanding as well.
Yeah, before I open it to the floor, just want to emphasize the fact that I think the increase in our prevalence of diabetes to 13% currently is primarily due to aging. And what is frightening is that our young adults are becoming more and more overweight and more obese. So the bottom line is that the worst is yet to be. That we are going to get more and more diabetics into the future, and our children, our grandchildren, are going to be the diabetics of the future. So the need to actually also be at the same time focusing on the young, and especially also the young adults.
May I make just one comment before? What you've said actually may be very prophetic, and things may never get any better for type 2 diabetes, and I'll tell you why. Many of you will be aware of the Dutch winter famine at the end of World War II, when there was a famine. It was still occupied by the Nazis, and some 40 or 50 years later, the children born at that time had much higher rates of diabetes, obesity, and heart disease. And there have been other examples of that now, the Chinese famine at the end of the 1950s, There's virtually no diabetes in China. Now there's 120 million people with diabetes. We've got the story I just said, diabetes begets diabetes, and this comes back to the Gusto study, that gestational diabetes, the children of those women are more likely to get diabetes. And the epigenetic change is actually intergenerational. So we may actually be sitting on in a very hot bed at the moment, that everything that's happening at the moment is only... And you can take groups of high-risk people and get them to exercise and lose weight when they're adults. But what's happening at the moment is that we have this whole epigenetic phenomenon now. And even here in Singapore and Malaysia, for example, which were occupied during World War II, there may have been impacts then on the children of born at that time, and that part of the reason for the very high rates of diabetes, for example, in Singapore and Malaysia and some of the other Asian countries, have got that epigenetic phenomenon, and which again I mentioned is intergenerational. So things may not get better.
Right, any questions or comments? Yes, please.
You look at the U.S. to see what's coming. 50% of people over age 65 in the U.S. who do not have diabetes have pre-diabetes. 50%. And that's what may be coming here, and that's what your comments allude to. It's frightening. Second issue. I'd like to raise about this population and high risk. So we know who's at high risk. It doesn't require a complex history and all the various disorders. Measure the fasting glucose, and that puts you at high risk by itself. I've been part of the diabetes prevention program in the U.S. since the beginning, about 20 years now. I know the intensity of the intervention that is involved. It is the most successful weight loss program that's ever been done. There were 7% weight loss in people in the intensive group in the diabetes prevention program in the U.S., and it was maintained for years. It takes an enormous effort. So this requires health professionals who can work with patients in an intensive way to achieve the wonderful outcomes. Medicare in the U.S. is just now agreeing to pay for that kind of intervention for high-risk people. Who is going to deliver that kind of intervention to high-risk people in Singapore, and who's going to pay for it?
Good point.
I have to pay out of pocket the cost. I have to be very, your message on TV's got to be really, really great to convince me to spend the thousands of dollars a year it will require for that kind of intervention.
Kenneth, you want to comment?
I'm not sure I can answer that question fully, but certainly I think we're already starting to pluck at the edges of this problem. We're starting out, first of all, of course, trying to get a better sensing. I think this is perhaps a bit of a segue into your next section as well. Starting to get trying to encourage people to step forward, understanding their risk, trying to get them to screen, trying to get them into a system of follow-up. And we have already started to think about how we want to fund and support this. It's existing in some of our programs. For example, the CHESS programs we have with the GPs, we're actually funding for two screen-related interventions per year for the population. of eligible people in this category. And certainly, I think as we move forward, there will be additional funding strategies that help to improve the take-up rate for screening and follow-up as well. But I think as we move up the sequence and now start looking at interventions to optimize diabetes management, again, we would have to look at what are the recommended interventions that we feel we need to support. And I'm quite sure the issue of whether or not we need to fund to provide that support for the population will be a conversation that we'll have to take at that point in time as well. So I'm not trying to dodge the question. I'm certainly not trying to suggest that I have an answer at this point in time. In fact, I think it's a problem that we're just about grappling at this point in time. But certainly, I think it's an issue we will be confronting. But we haven't actually got to the stage of talking about improving our funding for treatment strategies just yet.
Yes, Sen. Maybe you can identify yourself first. And then.
Hello. Yeah. So I'm Andrew. I am working in a multinational company, pharmaceutical company. For the purpose of the question I'm asking, I'm not going to disclose my employer. I provide occupational health service, or rather I'm an occupational health doctor for the company. So the reason, the theme that I'm going to ask is about the workplace strategy in terms of all this health promotion, health prevention and protection, because I've got issues and I don't know how to actually solve it. And to build up to the questions, I need to provide some context with regards to the challenges that I'm facing in the workplace while trying to promote the health of my employees. So we conduct annual health screening. Usually the take-up rate is about 40%, and 40% of the take-up rate is considered very good in the health workplace health screening when we compare with other multinational companies. And we identify X number of employees with chronic diseases. So we find that something is wrong because of the non-respondents. So we get hire a case manager to look through all the case files and identify nearly 100% of our employees through the health screening. And we find out additional 2.5x number of people with chronic diseases in a non-responder group. Okay, so then after that, the case manager will continue on. So in the bid for us to actually conduct the health screening, we approached a restructured hospital not in our zone area. Then they said that it is not part of our regional health system strategy, so we can't provide health screening for your company. So we approached another restructured hospital that's in our zone. Then they said that they are somehow not interested also. So we have to approach another other companies to actually help us to do all this health screening and promotion. So at the end of it all, my question is this. What is the workplace health strategy for us in the war of diabetes? So that's one. What is the workplace health strategy? Number two, have we also considered about some form of legislation approach similar to that of Japan, whereby employer or employees need to undergo some form of medical health check compulsorily in the workforce? Because workplace is a very captive audience. You just tweak the CEO and everything actually falls in line. Yeah.
Kenneth again.
Because when it comes to everything related to government, ministry and state, it becomes me. Eh? Well, actually, there are many people here in the audience who are also fully empowered to take on some of these questions. So so some of these questions, in fact, they may also follow through as well. We are moving into talking about screening and basically what is the value of then workplace-related screening interventions, which are more targeted, more focused compared to a more community population-based screening. It's a bit of a follow-on with the conversations we had when we talked about risk factor and whether or not we should also be engaging in both population and targeted screening as well. Certainly, we continue with our national screening strategies and campaigns, and we have a Screen for Life campaign in which Health Promotion Board, in fact, is helping to lead and helping us to provide strategic direction in terms of how this should be done. They commission various people in addition to commissioning, providing some screening efforts locally. And they've in fact also been working with People's Association, with the regional health systems for that purpose. They haven't perhaps got to your particular company, but certainly I think if you express interest in participating and opening up access to your workplace for Screen for Life campaigns and interventions, then I think they'll be very interested to talk to you as well. At the national level, we are actually not opposed to more targeted workplace-based screening. We in fact found that when we talk about Screen for Life screening, depending on the setup where you are, and data coming out also from the various campaigns, there's a certain amount of recruitment and attendance coming on. But in fact, we saw greater capture of certain segments of the population when we carried out certain more focused interventions. A case in point was when we started looking at taxi drivers and bus drivers, and we actually went down to the workplace to identify them and actually invite them to come for screening, because we realized to some extent they were a bit of a captive group. Why do I say captive? Because when we looked at how to deal with a segment of the workforce that in fact, by nature of their population, have a very sedentary lifestyle. Can you imagine? You're working in shift for the entire day, maybe 12 hours. That's 12 hours sitting in your cab. That's 12 hours of not exercising and doing anything at all. And certainly, one would not be surprised if they have hurried meals, that their lifestyle choices in terms of what they eat also would be a compromise. So, but we realized that when we talk about these taxi drivers, every month they were all aggregating, coming to one place, because their companies required all their taxis to go for inspection on a monthly basis. And when their vehicles are being inspected and serviced, that's at least 2-3 hours sitting there doing nothing, waiting at NTUC or elsewhere. It became a opportunity to catch them, to provide some for education message and invite them to come for screening. In fact, then the screening, I don't have the exact results with me right now, but in fact, it was a very significant increase in screening capture that just took place as a result of one single identifying that one single group of people and identifying where the opportunity was that we could in fact come to them, where they aggregate, provide an educational focus, reach out to them, and then actually invite them for screening. Subsequently, of course, screening is not just screen detecting the presence of diabetes. Screening must also include having a viable strategy for following up those who are actually screen detected of diabetes. We've similarly seen a high rate for this subgroup captured this way for actually falling through with that first appointment to see a doctor, whether in the workplace, whether in the regional health systems, specialist clinics, in the polyclinics or the CHAS credentialed GPs as well. So selectively, if we can actually find such opportunities, we're not opposed to now having a more targeted look at providing a more focused, a higher intense screening effort for a subgroup of the population. But we need to identify the factors that may lead to success in these interventions that will help to support the wide-based, community-based screening that we actually engaged in. And if you think that in your workplace, there are good opportunities to do so, we'd be very happy to talk to you. Now, Derek's there, and he's going to help to provide more meat to this answer.
No, I'm trying to let Kenneth answer all the questions. So, well, my day job is in MOH, Public Health. I think I'm speaking here as an adjunct staff of the School of Public Health. So I have some technical questions.
My job.
So I think in terms of Paul's comment about epigenetic changes, I think I look at it a bit differently to say that actually, first of all, I think when you talk about the differences in diabetes prevalence between Asia, you know, and in the US, I think the issue about, you know, feast versus famine, I think it's a very strong hypothesis that actually not all the differences are due to genetic changes, because the genes don't change in the generation, but we do see rapid changes you know, in diabetes prevalence within a generation. Therefore, there must be something environmental to it. But whether you could argue whether it's a gene that's predisposing towards environmental susceptibility, that's the question. So the question basically is, do epigenetic changes get transmitted to the next generation, right? So we have a group who have suffered through World War II, you know, in the 50s and 60s, and for them, I think one could argue that you know, during the womb, right, they were sort of, the womb was in sort of famine conditions, and they grew up in a feast condition. But the next generation that we're going to see actually will have grown up both in the womb and grown up in feast conditions. So the question is whether we see a change in that. Now, whether there will be a harm, and then once you get over the harm, things will improve, right, in that sense. So I asked Paul about the evidence behind that. The other issue, I think, would be commenting on the comment on interventions for IFG and IGT. So I think we are well aware that in a clinical trial setting, right, the main thing is to get a p-value to show an effect. Therefore, right, I've done trials before, therefore select very high-risk groups, and you've put in very intensive interventions, and you want to show something changes. And that, I think, is undisputed that, you know, you can impact on the risk of IFG and IGD if you intervene very intensively in a very high risk group. Right, then the question basically when it comes to policy basically is that how do we then translate it to a scalable, sustainable intervention at the national level? Right, so the thing is that can we afford to have intervention to the kind of intensity in DPP for an estimated 300,000 to 400,000 people with IFG, okay, in Singapore, right? Or do we say that actually, you know, once we identify them, we then leverage on existing community programs that are available already for the general community, except that of course for these people, you may want to intensify, you want to step up the intensity, they may be a bit more motivated. But I think the question is still open on how we design such interventions. The last point to make basically is that people may not be aware of certain statistics in the landscape of screening. So actually the vast majority of screening occurs in primary care. Okay, for one, there's a group of people who already have hypertension, cholesterol, they already have follow up with their GPs, right? And in our statistics, most of these people are actually screened by the primary carer, as they should be, right? For the group that are not on follow up, right, then the question, even in this group, more than half are actually screened in primary care in current practice, right? Having said that, as Kenneth mentioned, there is certain hard to reach groups, taxi drivers, for example, who will never have a time to see a GP because that means loss of income. So I think we need to target these risk groups, right, for workplace, but we do not want to sort of lose sight of the fact that primary care is very important, right, in terms of screening landscape.
Paul, you want to talk about the epigenetic, whether the next generation where they are not in famine would actually be a positive epigenetic effect lower the next generation of diabetics.
No. The first thing I learned in my career is never to try and answer a question that I can't get a grip on. And I look, type 2 diabetes, about the only thing we know about type 2 diabetes that we're very sure of is the fact that if you take some high-risk subjects and you get them in a program like the American or the Indian, Chinese interventions, we can prevent new diabetes. We still don't understand we talk about heterogeneity of diabetes, we don't understand actually the mechanisms, we haven't got the right drugs yet to deal with it. So I'm being very simplistic. In terms of the epigenetic story, people have ignored it. We all talk about the diabetogenic environment and the impact on people at high risk because they've got a family history or something. I've got to tell you, the GUSTO study is the first prospective study in the world that will answer the question, which we've got data based on retrospective studies in Holland, in China, Cambodia, Ukraine, where there's been famines, and 30 to 40 years later we see epidemics of diabetes. And I think the epigenetic is a roll-on effect. We're looking for drugs now, actually. Firstly, we have to work out a correct epigenetic marker that tells us that someone was either in a famine situation or the mother had gestational diabetes, and then try and knock out the epigene, so to speak. But I think you've raised a very important question, but I can't answer it. At the moment, I spend a lot of time in Australia. I was on the National Obesity Task Force for the government. Very little's happened with that. I've now co-chaired the National Diabetes Strategy. And we got past on the issue of prevention each time the task force said, let's spend more time thinking about maternal and child health because it's 30 to 40 years later now that we're looking. You said it takes a while to know whether a community intervention reduces diabetes. We still don't know to what extent epigenetics play a role, and I think Singapore's way ahead of the game in this area, leading. And I'm sorry I haven't answered your question.
Yeah, so I think one important point to recognize is that as academics, there are many interesting hypotheses, many interesting research that we can be doing in this whole area of newer risk factors and newer markers and so forth. But on the other hand, in terms of population intervention, public health interventions, there may not be that much in the sense that is known. And I think we have to recognize that tension. That relates to epigenetics, that relates to sleep, and a lot of other newer areas like diana, the factors and so forth. They may not be ready for prime time public health interventions. Therefore, the concern is the messaging is very important. And secondly, there need to be also looking into, are there other ways of messaging the epigenetics and so forth in a way that the lay public actually understand? So for example, just focusing on the prevention of even gestational diabetes by having good nutrition, good lifestyle during pregnancy, okay? And adding to that, that it may impact the next generation. So we may not need to actually fully understand right now in terms of, say, the epigenetic pathways and so forth to get across a simple public health intervention or a simple public health message. And I think academics have to also recognize that if we push our course too much, our pet topic too much, we actually cause confusion. And at the end of the day, public health is about getting the entire community engaged towards a particular direction. But let's move on to, I think, the next segment on the screening. I think we did mention a little bit about screening. And one of the aim of screening is, to mop up the number of, or reduce the number of undiagnosed diabetics. So, Paul, in Australia, what kind of strategies or what kind of programs are actually targeted at identifying the undiagnosed diabetics?
I'll try and be brief on this. I'm sure I've got better experts here. So, at the moment, I think it's generally recognised that trying to do screening across a whole population is not cost effective. So here we are back to talking about the high risk group, the people with family history of diabetes, people who have got high blood pressure, people who are obese, women with polycystic ovary syndrome, disorders, you know, people on drugs that might cause diabetes. And certain ethnic groups. In Australia, our indigenous community have a rate of or prevalence of diabetes three times higher than the European-based community. So how do we go about this? Well, clearly you've all seen on World Diabetes Day and whatnot here, people with little glucose measuring machines in the street and saying, well, do you want to know if you've got diabetes? And they're fine as long as if someone's discovered to have diabetes, they're actually followed up. So that's a conventional way. What's emerging around the world, and I think it started mainly in Finland, is the development of questionnaires. There may be 20 simple questions, and if you get a bad score, if you get a good score, you go top of the grade, that's fine. But if you get a high score, that suggests you should then go to your primary care doctor and ask for a blood test, which can be a fasting blood test in the first instance, or if they haven't fasted, you can do a random glucose, but then if it's high, you should repeat it. In Australia, we did in the year 2000, I led a team that did the first ever national diabetes study, which was called AusDiab. And from that study, we developed a risk questionnaire. It's called AusRisk, Australian Diabetes Risk Score, which is based on the Finnish one. And that is actually available on the internet. It's advertised by government as a way for people in the community to check whether they're at risk of diabetes and whether they should then go and have a screening test, firstly to go to their primary healthcare doctors. And of course, you have to then teach the primary health care doctors what they should do if someone's got a high blood sugar.
Kenneth, Singapore's model?
Actually, I have a lot of problems with this issue of undiagnosed diabetics. Of course, and when we grapple and try and form a strategy how to reduce this group and diagnose diabetics, we have to recognize there's a lot of heterogeneity in this particular group. And trying to define this group in itself is a challenge sometimes. And I liken it to perhaps one of those wicked problems that sometimes we see in healthcare, because the problem is not easy to define, let alone trying to find solutions. So let me perhaps try to deconstruct this a little bit to help to people to appreciate the complexity of trying to form a strategy of how to reduce this group. First of all, we've got a group of people who have actually no awareness of what diabetes is all about. And they not only may not be aware of diabetes as a condition, they may not be aware of the or have an insight that diabetes can affect them and can have disastrous consequences in their life. We are also having a problem with people because diabetes is a disease that starts off relatively asymptomatic. And even when they start having early symptoms, many people don't even have the insight to be aware that it's in fact ascribable to a diabetic condition in the first place. So there's a lack of understanding that leads therefore to a lack of being willing to step up to discover whether whether they have diabetes. Then if we now introduce also the lack of awareness of risk factors that predispose them to in fact having an increased risk of getting diabetes, that sort of complicates the situation and leads to a very low level of awareness among diabetics, particularly in the early, relatively asymptomatic stage. The second problem we have is, of course, that existing screening campaigns that we have tend not to reach out to the larger population. We tend to be a lot more focused in certain areas, but we tend to capture people towards their more senior years, perhaps because they are easier to reach out to. It's not wrong to want to reach out to them. But if we really want to tackle diabetes, understanding the long latency effect, where you want to control their diabetic condition early before they actually start getting end organ disease, it's a bit late to diagnose diabetes, to be honest, when you're already in your 60s and 70s, and you already have set in entrenched the complications of diabetes, including atherosclerosis. You want to tackle them very early on. We, in fact, have a less mature strategy for screening that hits the younger age groups. So that needs to be also something that we need to work at. Derek mentioned about how most of our screening is taking place now with our general practitioners, and that is a fact. But we also now have to deal with a population, particularly the younger population, who do not see their GPs as people that they will work with in this area of preventive health. They regard the GPs as a place to go to for episodic acute care of a certain acuity, and the interactions with their GPs are along those lines. You can even say that they have a family physician, but they don't really bring that family physician into a very close relationship, keeping that family physician at arm's length, and only seeing the family physician when they actually have a problem. But here, we're actually trying to bring across that notion that for the patients with relatively early onset diabetes, we still want you to have a close relationship with a family physician for the purposes of following up and improving your control of your condition, even in that early, relatively asymptomatic phase, which is a challenge in itself for us. Then, of course, we need to also look at what is the best way of picking up all these diabetics once we bring them into a screening campaign, find the correct tool for which we would diagnose their diabetes. Our problem then is in how we follow up, because in fact, we have a relatively high fallout rate among screen-detected diabetes where they don't actually follow through and then subsequently see and continue a relationship with a family physician. If we look at the Screen for Life campaigns and we, in fact, use our internal MOH data to sort of match with the same individuals who actually then are following through with either a polyclinic, a CHAS-related GP or specialist clinic, at best only something between 48-55%. And it's just about half of the people who are screen-detected actually end up continuing to see a doctor subsequently to follow up for that condition. So there's a large dropout rate, and that needs to be tackled as well. So when we look at this issue of how to reduce the growth of undiagnosed diabetics, it's actually quite a thorny issue because there are multiple facets of this problem that need to be plugged at, and we can't really just bank on one particular strategy that's going to work, and we will now use that as the anchor strategy just simply to reduce this growth of undiagnosed diabetics.
So if we've deconstructed some of the problems and challenges, and accepting that I haven't probably even outlined all the issues in this group of diabetics, we need to now have a multifaceted strategy to help, to put in place. When it comes to the issue of education, we still need to come back to this this broad-based population educational strategy that we need to put in place to allow the population to understand what diabetes is, the natural history and the attendant complications of diabetes that have a disastrous impact on their life. And we have to now figure a way of allowing them to internalize and develop the insight that affects them as a whole and not just a theoretical consideration that affects the population. Many of our individuals cannot understand a population risk. They can understand when the risk affects them. And while we engage in a population-based education strategy, that strategy has to be sufficiently nuanced that, in fact, the person feels that he's receiving a message that's internalized and specific for him himself. Then comes the understanding that he needs to appreciate what his risks are for getting diabetes. And this is where Paul's example of having risk prognostication or risk prediction tools is in fact very important. But these risk prediction tools have to be cleverly and carefully designed. It's enough to talk about having a 20-point scale, but it needs to be something that the public can easily do and the public can easily understand and appreciate their risk. It has to be relatively validated to our local situation, and sometimes there may be parameters and measures in risk tools taken overseas that need to, in fact, be customized and adjusted to a local context. And that has to be done clearly in the design and introduction of such a risk tool. We are working on that piece. We hope by sometime early next year, we would have something that we can bring across and integrate into our educational and communication strategies that allow the public to understand whether they fall into a high-risk group, and they should. We strongly encourage them to step forward for screening. The third piece that we have to work on then is in relation to how we want to improve our screening efforts. And we're working very closely with HBB on their Screen for Life campaigns, helping them to, in fact, to strengthen and amplify their roll-up so that, in fact, we hope to capture as many as possible of people who fall into this group. But we also need to understand that there may be a need for a many hands approach, where it's not just HBB taking ownership. And in fact, already we're working with the regional health system in community-based approaches. What is key then in that setting is to provide information to our regional health system and community partners so that they identify where the low-lying fruits are in terms of who they should be reaching out to at the grassroots and community level. And we've endeavored to open up access to data that we hold about where our diabetic patients are so that perhaps if they can reach out to the families of these diabetic patients, there may be, in fact, a greater yield in picking up people who fall into this category of the undiagnosed diabetics. We also are looking at the high-risk approach. And from the high-risk approach, we're also working to see whether or not those who are already identified as already at increased risk for getting diabetes, whether a more intensive approach towards screening them at regular intervals, not just a one-off effort, that can also improve our rates of detection of patients in their early phase of diabetes. So it includes not letting go on patients with a history of gestational diabetes. It's not enough for us to diagnose them as having GDM, then following up with a fasting glucose level after delivery, and then being comforted that the fasting level normalizes, and then saying that they are back to normal and therefore there's no need for further follow-up. We're starting to create registers, trying to create programs now where they will continue on a more sustained long-term follow-up, so that, in fact, we can then track when they will get diabetes later on in life as well, despite normalizing of their fasting sugar levels after delivery of their child. So a whole basket of interventions needs to take place, and it cannot be a one-size-fits-all approach where we only deal with one, assuming that that gives us greatest bang for buck. The group of patients with undiagnosed diabetics is heterogeneous, and there are many interplaying gaps in the system that require us to plug at systematically before, in fact, we are confident we can truly reduce this group of undiagnosed diabetics.
Perhaps I can ask the audience whether you have any suggestions, you know, or ideas as to how can we reduce the number of undiagnosed diabetics in Singapore.
Hello. Hello, my name is... Yes, my name is Norbert. I'm an associate professor at the School of Public Health. I don't have solutions, as you ask, he's saying, but maybe something that could make it easier. Part of my work is working in total workplace safety and health programs in Singapore. And in that topic, I had several discussions last week with health and safety engineers, safety officers, and two things came up regarding the health screening that essentially worried me. And I wonder if we as a society have to learn to live differently with chronic diseases. Two questions came up. When we talked about health screening at the workplace, what Andrew mentioned, some of the engineers said, oh, Prof, no, cannot. So what's wrong? Well, they said, you know, if you diagnose somebody, he might get fired. So obviously that is a problem, which I would like to raise the question, do we not have to include a message of accepting or living with chronic disease very, very strongly in the campaigns, and maybe going as far as having an anti-discrimination law, that it's at least illegal to fire somebody because he has a chronic disease, because at a certain age, 60% of people have chronic diseases somehow. So that was question number one, which actually somebody who is offered a screening, if he is smart, he doesn't go to the screening. So that is very dysfunctional for our purposes. The second is similar. I'm not from Singapore, so I was told several times that when people get another job or they can, you know, get a better job, you have to go for pre-employment medical. Same thing applies. If something is discovered, A, you might not get the job because you're discriminated against, even though it has in 90%, 99% nothing to do with your work. And B, you might lose your health insurance coverage, which raises the question, is, so to say, the systems, how we deal with chronic diseases in the society in Singapore, are they aligned to actually help the campaigns? If these very strong forces, because they go towards the pockets, go against, so to say, the goal of the campaigns, then maybe the campaigns will not be effective. So question number one is, do we need an anti-discrimination regulation or law? And second, do we need to change our health coverage packages and say, everybody with chronic disease is welcome, we just redo our mathematical calculation for the premiums?
Thanks, Norbert. I'm glad you brought this up, because I think this are a lot of issues at the ground level. That has been raised as well. And it's a question also of sometimes perception. Employers may not be out to fire the worker with a chronic disease, but a worker has that perception. And just having that perception is already bad enough. And secondly, the portability of insurance, workplace insurance, is a big issue.
I agree. There are many very important points that actually you've raised. And I think the first that we must acknowledge, and it must be woven into the narrative that we have when we try to increase public awareness and education of what diabetes is all about, is to destigmatize the fact that people have diabetes. We regard this as a very negative connotation. We, in fact, have perverse incentives for people not to come for screening. I don't want to know. There's now this ostrich head in the sand mentality that some people will have, which goes against our attempts to try to get them to have a better understanding of what diabetes is about. We also don't want diabetics in the community to be treated as lepers, not lepers as to denigrate that particular condition, but in the biblical sense, how there was a negative connotation in the beginning of what lepers were. So in that sense, we do not want diabetics to go around with this perception that they're going to be negatively treated and managed, whether at home, whether in society, whether in the workplace. So we have to figure out a way and try and bring across that element of the narrative. But it's also important that it must be given its proper proportional emphasis, and it should not in itself also overshadow the entire conversation of what diabetes is all about.
it can threaten to do so, and we have to also carefully manage this part of the educational piece. It's an important piece not to dodge, but it also must be put in its correct perspective. The area of policy making when it comes to anti-discrimination laws and so on goes beyond diabetes. It goes into HIV, it goes into other things, and we start moving into a climate where we also have to consider genetic testing, screening, and so on. These would inevitably also questions that are raised in relation to those as well. So we do need to perhaps take more time to think through how we want to work through our strategies and policies. But we also need to recognize that this is not something that we will hold on our own in the healthcare sector. There are social agencies and social elements. They need to be brought in. It needs to be woven into a larger national fabric, this conversation. And in that sense, while we understand the importance of destigmatizing, I'm not sure we're ready, to be honest, at this stage to take the next step of introducing anti-discrimination laws. But in fact, we must have that conversation about what it means to destigmatize. And one of the options is to consider these options. And I think it's important that we take a few steps down that road and see how far it goes in this particular journey.
Any other comments or suggestions from the floor? Hang on.
Hi, sorry, I'm a bit clumsy today. My name is Alex. I'm with the Singapore Armed Forces. And actually, I wanted to bring up this question earlier, but now that Mr. Kenneth Mark has mentioned it, how much do you see this problem of war on diabetes, or the very existence that we declared war on diabetes, just a very, very tall iceberg that is now presenting itself to us about the failings of policy, the failings of primary care, the failings of our society to overcome some of the big challenges for health in general? I see the war on diabetes is just one small battle when it comes to disease prevention and delivering healthcare that people want and need. I think, you know, we've all raised these points, and we're sort of like circulating, we're walking in circles around the big issues here, which is, number one, our primary healthcare providers are not incentivized to hunt down the diabetics. Number two, some of the policies that we have are constrained by Ministry of Trade and Industry, other ministries of manpower. And I thought that maybe, is there any way that we could harness this narrative of a war on diabetes to really push the other segments of society that you mentioned into action? So I think maybe for all of the panelists, the question is, how much is the war on diabetes just a harbinger of perhaps worse things to come? Thank you.
I think we could sit here for hours arguing whether the term's good or what. I think conceptually we've had a war on HIV, that brought more funding, more recognition. I actually like the term. We've been using that term internationally, you know, jokingly, and in one sense saying, you know, we have to declare a war on diabetes. I think the idea, it's the concept, and of course the government, it's the responsibility of the government now and other agencies to make sure that people who are at risk get better attention, people who've got diabetes. So I think it's just a public awareness thing, and I think hopefully the points you raise will just flow if you've got a committed government. This is why I raised it earlier on. There's a lot out there. You know, you open, I don't know how many people here read the Straits Times. It's probably not the audience to get a survey, but you open the Straits Times today and it's the first story up on the left about diabetes. And I think it's very important. It's one of the major health threats internationally. It hasn't been recognized as such. And hopefully the use of the term here, it's more than just a gesture, and it will be a lead to the sort of, you know, actions that you've raised develop. I think that's probably all we could say. I don't know. Sue hasn't seen it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, before Swen says anything, just to respond immediately to Alex. Alex, I'm actually not that pessimistic. I don't see the issue as a failing of society, a failure of the efforts of individuals or of our organizations and agencies. But I think it's just the issue of accepting there are many issues that are on our plate. And it sometimes takes a better understanding and insight to recognize where our system gaps are, and then committing a wherewithal to actually move ahead and confront these issues. So what is coming out from the war on diabetes is less the issue of increasing perception that there are failures, but increasing understanding that, in fact, there are many gaps that we need to sort out. So I'd like to perhaps reframe the conversation a bit by using that particular term. What I've seen in the war on diabetes is that, in fact, there is now a national willingness, and I say national deliberately, because there is a national there's an understanding at higher levels that this takes effort beyond just healthcare. It is not a Ministry of Health initiative. The war on diabetes is not that. The fact that I've got two co-chairmen of our national task force, one from the Educational Ministry and one from the Ministry of Health, should already give a certain signal that we recognize that this is a whole of government effort, and that, in fact, the road towards engineering a change in our next generation of people must go through our schools, go through our educational effort, and it takes a lot more than just interventions that occur on the healthcare front. And it's important we recognize that, in fact, for many of our healthcare problems, they are wicked, right? The difficulty that we have in defining the problem also implies it's because we have reframed the problem in the wrong sense. But we look at it and understand that, in fact, it's a larger issue, then there must be also a willingness to provide the larger set of resources as well to deal with those issues. At a different level, our Diabetes Program Office has a strong engagement, in fact, with industry. And we, in fact, have a strong engagement with EDB, for example. And EDB is helping us to facilitate and co-lead designathons with commercial and MNCs to work through some of the problems through challenge statements that we provide on the healthcare end. So, as an example, we are in fact looking at not just interventions and strategies that only occur in the healthcare space. We're looking to see how we want to shape and change the mindset and work out strategies that have a more societal impact using some of these other levers that go beyond healthcare as well. So I think we need to understand we have gaps in our system, but it's remarkable that we've actually reached a stage where we're willing to confront this and use societal levers to deal with this issue together. There are many countries who are trying to work on a strategy for diabetes, but there are also many countries that have not, in fact, developed that insight and still regard diabetes as a healthcare problem. Diabetes is not just a healthcare problem. It requires much more resources than just what healthcare can provide. The impact of diabetes is not just on the health of an individual, but it's not just the state of health of a society, but there's a lot more ramifications that affect society in larger spaces as well. And it's only if we, as a country, as a nation, embrace that larger understanding, can we, in fact, move forward to do something decisively for a condition like this. And as I mentioned earlier, diabetes for us is not just one label. When the war on diabetes first came out, I had many doctors coming to me and ask why I didn't declare a war on cancer, why I didn't have a war on trauma, arguing that trauma is a disease, why I didn't have a war on many other things. But the important thing also to understand is that if we want to plug system gap and impose system changes, we may use diabetes as a placeholder for some of our strategies moving forward. But we are deliberate in understanding that the strategies are more, if sustainable, have a wider reaching implication on the state of health in other areas as well. So we're really looking at system change rather than than only focusing our attention on one condition called diabetes.
So, Alex, I totally understand where your question is coming from. And I think I come at that from the perspective of someone who, when the war was declared, a lot of friends, family, colleagues who are not in diabetes said to me, "Wow, now war declared, you must be very busy, good business, huh?" And I said, for us, it's the same thing. We've been doing what we've been doing, and we've been doing what we believe in, and we realize this, and that doesn't change. So I think what is the meaning of this war? And I'd like to offer that from the perspective of a family member of several family members who have diabetes, who live with the disease day in, day out, and what it means to a person. I have many friends as well, some around our ages, who do have type 2, not just type 1 diabetes. I'd also like to offer perspectives as a provider of care to persons with diabetes. And I'm not in government, so I certainly don't have the same perhaps insights and perspectives and authority as Kenneth does. But I've had the privilege of working with many in that whole ecosystem that several governmental agencies at the national and regional, international level, work with and having the privilege of seeing their responses and interacting with them ever since this war was declared. I also like to go one step beyond that and even say beyond public sector, also what the private sector responses have been since this war was declared. So I'll try and cover those four areas very, very briefly. I think at the person level, I'd like to say beyond family members, I volunteer at a region, is in Kampong Glam, so it's central, but there are 9 blocks of rental flats there. And I can tell you that not a single one of us sitting in this room has a finger on the pulse of reality that people face on a daily basis, okay? So whatever, you know, we can debate, and I'm not saying it's not important, because I'll caveat this with, I started my career as a basic researcher, and I still do that, I still research molecules and so on, but those seem so far removed from the daily challenges and decisions that people have to make in this so-called war against diabetes, and what does it really mean to them on a daily basis. I think that I've noticed that since this war was declared, people have become a lot more aware. Whether they necessarily feel empowered at this stage to really do something differently about it, I think remains to be seen. But there are steps forward, and I think at least that first step is seemingly occurring. Yeah. The second piece about providers, I think, pertains to clinicians. I mean, I give a lot of talks to primary care providers, and Chatham House rules apply. So I'm going to tell you very honestly, there can be a whole variety, right? Sometimes I give a talk about diabetes and management of diabetes, and it's quite evident to me that they're there because they have to get CME points, and they want to eat lunch, and there's a good lunch. And if I have something interesting enough to say, they might perk up every now and again, and as soon as the best course of the lunch is served, they say, thank you very much, and then they'll dash off. Ever since this, I mean, I have noticed that, again, people are taking more and more of an interest. They're asking questions, they're more just interested, and I think that is also a good sign. I mean, these are all anecdotal, so I don't have a clear outcomes indicator that I can show you, but I do sense a certain change that's emerging. At the agency level, I mean, I think, you know, there, as Kenneth has highlighted, how various different agencies are coming together, trying to make concerted efforts. We are seeing ministries, and I think we'll cover that perhaps in even our third segment about, you know, funding incentives, etc. I think we still have a long way to go, but at least I think those conversations are progressing. Last but not least, from the private sector and even collaborations with industry, I think a lot have commented that, you know, in the US they've declared war on cancer. They think it's remarkable that a country like Singapore, in a sense, pardon the French, has the guts to declare war on diabetes. And so I start, and Alex, like you, I think, somewhat skeptical about all this hype and publicity, and I said, it doesn't really change what we do. But I suppose if it does translate into some palpable changes that we see in our lifetime, then call it war, call it whatever you want. I think if it has been an impetus for some change, a whole of society, I wouldn't even say whole of government, it's a whole of society approach, then I think it would have made a difference. And I think we have to be mindful that this is, we mustn't be so compelled to just win the battle, but it's really a war, and it's a long-term thing. And I'm very encouraged to hear Kenneth talk about outcomes that stretch beyond one life cycle.
We're seeing a groundswell of responses to the war on diabetes, and a lot of things we are not even mentioning or not even publicizing, but in fact there is a groundswell. After the Committee of Supply speech that Minister gave where the war on diabetes was announced, I'll tell you, in very short order, we had ministers and MPs coming to us demanding for us to open up data so that they knew where the diabetics were in their own communities, because they wanted to launch grassroots outreach activities, either to help to support them, to provide help for them, to provide more educational and motivation and a peer support level, trying to help to detect more diabetics who live in their vicinity as well. And what Swee is talking about is just one example of her activity, her interaction at grassroots, but I'll tell you that's duplicated in many other areas as well. And we had whole GRCs getting involved in this as well. Then we had industry coming in, and I had a few of us here in the audience. We actually attended a dinner. Moss Chi was there at the dinner. We were engaging the Singapore Manufacturing Federation. And one of the representatives came up and slid an envelope to Minister, slid an envelope to me. And I worry, you know, when someone outside slips you an envelope in a private function, you worry whether you're going to open up and you see money inside or something like that. Huh? We opened the envelope to find it's a list of 90 representatives from the SMF coming forward, stepping forward, volunteering their services, their company services to help in the war on diabetes. And they were mainly in the F&B industry. They were willing to come together to partner to see whether or not they could help make better, healthy, nutritional choices available to the public. So there's a certain groundswell activities that we're not publicizing, so people don't really understand the tip. But we've actually seen a large change in the effort. It's no longer a situation where the ministry must lead in everything. But we are now, in fact, moving to an area where there's a lot of public-private partnerships, and there's, in fact, a lot of leadership that is actually taking place that's, in fact, not generated by the ministry. At best, we are having an idea where what's going on. We're keeping track on things. We're facilitating, we're aligning, we're coordinating. But I would not pretend to say that we have the leadership, the thought leadership in many of these initiatives that actually are starting to roll out on the ground. And that's the effort that's starting to take place just because we declared something called a war on diabetes. Now, how much of this is going to be sustainable is an important question. If we can harness all that energy on the ground properly, this can be a sustainable effort. But the public tend to be quite fickle-minded. We latch on to a particular activity, it captures our attention. Then after a few years, we move on to the next bright idea, the next sexy thing that comes on our way. We need now, in this space, before the public's attention moves on to the next game in town, we need to now bring into effect all those changes we want to make in the system that now are sustainable, that will see us through this long journey towards improving our rates of diabetes. It's not a one-off effort, but we need now to capitalize while the iron is hot, to move through and push through some of these changes that take place. And this is what we're trying to do, our efforts are. So yes, you can position it sometimes as a failure. I see it very optimistically. We're seeing now a huge change in the landscape we've not seen before. Time will tell whether the efforts we take traction and see success in many endeavors. I think some of the pilots will fail. Some of the pilots will fail not because of lack of effort. Some of the pilots will fail because we can't mainstream, but that's fine. There'll be many other ideas that will gain traction and will be sustainable, scalable, and will mainstream. And it's those initiatives that will win the day. So it's a marathon we're running. It's not the 100-meter dash.
Let's move on to the next segment, because time is catching up. That's on the management of or the control of diabetes. Maybe Suwen, just from your own personal clinical practice, how do you actually empower patient to take ownership of the condition?
So I think it's very important to understand the person that is sitting in front of you. And in a forum like this, I wanted to be very clear that we are going to work towards, first and foremost, how to balance when you're a clinician with a patient sitting in front of you. You're balancing a one-to-one equation, right? And when you're in a forum like this and in Kenneth's position, you have to balance a one-to-many lens. And that is in itself challenging, but I think that it is why we're all here today, to be able to move that needle so that we capture as many as possible. And then those that still fall through the cracks, we have still different ways of managing them. Now, then with that perspective, I'd like to come back to what we can do on a one-to-one basis. In my practice, for any new patient with diabetes, the first thing I always do is really tell them to tell me about their day. And by that, I mean that I really go through a typical day with them. What time do you wake up? I get information about their sleep, their jobs. It's important to understand whether they work shifts, what kind of jobs they do. Taxi driver versus corporate, accountant versus investment banker, very different, right? Retiree and so on. And then walk me through what you have for breakfast, what do you have for lunch, what times, what do you eat? Do you do any exercise? Exercise too much, hard work? What kind of physical activity do you do? So I basically take a food and a physical activity diary, if you like, or history. And with that, I think my job as a care provider is really to try and adapt how I can give them advice that is useful to them. And I always start with three things. Food, what kind of food choices, physical activity, and then where appropriate, medications. How do you tailor? I think what's very exciting for us now is that we have so many more options when it comes to medications that are available for diabetes than we ever had 5-10 years ago. And it's important because these new medications have the ability to reduce the side effects that you get and can improve the quality of life of the person with diabetes tremendously. So I think our jobs as care providers is to really to recommend things that fit with their day-to-day life, including medications that fit, and make it easier for them to really be empowered to manage their own diabetes on a daily basis. This is not rocket science, and so I feel that every primary care physician can be empowered with this, and what we can do is really help to equip them with that knowledge and understanding. Secondly, I think there are obviously some challenges that primary care providers do face. I'm not perhaps talking about providers that are plugged into very big practices or systems, but for example, the singleton GPs, right? I think a lot of them, it's not for lack of desire or motivation, perhaps. They are interested, but they feel that they just have too many barriers. And some of the barriers include perhaps this knowledge and understanding to an extent. They sometimes say, oh, it sounds all very clear at the end of a CME talk. But when I'm out in the clinic again, and then I have this permutation and that permutation, I'm like, oh no, okay, how does it go? So perhaps one of the ways that we should look into is how can we more appropriately support them on a more continual basis? And I think, you know, once they get the hang of things as well, that required support may diminish over time. There's also resources, I think, in terms of screening, infrastructure-related resources that a singleton GP sometimes finds difficult. We often talked about a multidisciplinary approach. And I think, again, I wanted to be clear that it's not that every person with diabetes needs the full works, a SWAT team to come, multidisciplinary team. Yes, perhaps those with complications and several comorbidities might. But then if you're a newly diagnosed person with diabetes, you may need certain inputs, but it's not like you necessarily need an entire SWAT team with you all the time. So how can we better resource GPs in a manner that is efficient and effective to be able to access some of these things when they need, but not have to carry the very high costs associated with some of these services? And then I think last but not least, Alex also mentioned funding incentives and structures. I guess the truth of the matter is at the moment, for GPs to see acute cases, coughs and colds, it makes a lot more economic sense, right? Because the turnover is a lot faster. I just told you about asking them about the day, so we've got time to ask about the day, and you know the structures are not aligned in that manner. So I think those are some of the issues and things that we ought to look into.
Okay, thanks, Ren. Any views or questions?
Yes, that's terrific. The challenge for GPs is really extraordinary. In the U.S., I don't know what the drug situation is here in Singapore. In the U.S., there are 11 different classes of non-insulin agents for managing hyperglycemia. Classes. There's over 50 different non-insulin drugs. There are about 15 to 20 different types of insulin. So just for management of hyperglycemia, how is a GP going to sort through all this and know what to do? So we need something better. And I said insulin, how can we not mention insulin on World Diabetes Day? And also, it is the birthday today of Frederick Banting. And if you open Google, there's a little line. You know, Google has its things. Today, there's a picture of Frederick Banting.
So Jeff was just has raised what I wanted to say. Basically, diabetes doesn't only have complications, it's very complicated to manage. And of all, you say, why is there a war on diabetes? I'll tell you why, because we not only do we have to let patients know about diabetes, we have to actually get the government, a message to the government, how complicated it is to manage and how many resources you need. We, for individuals, I mean, we have people with diabetes who actually face up, you know, several times a week and cause a lot of problem for their GP. We call them frequent flyers. And they need a lot of attention. But the situation is that there are so many levels where we can help. That firstly, diabetes is a full-time job. GPs normally have 300-400 different conditions to manage. We can't expect them to know how to adjust insulin doses, which of the 11 drug classes is appropriate for any individual person. What about nutritional advice to people? What about making sure they see an eye specialist at least once a year, that they have cardio? It is a hell of a job. So where do you start? Firstly, and of course, the GP looks after a patient who ends up in hospital with an amputation or a chest infection, and then they don't get the feedback from the hospital or to the primary healthcare person what's happened, so there's a change of therapy. So the first thing we need is better communication within the medical profession between the different levels of care of the person with diabetes. So it just goes on and on and on in terms of care. We have setups, and I know you'll have them here, two diabetes centres where you have a dietitian, a psychologist, an exercise physiologist. All these people are needed to help manage diabetes. The GPs don't necessarily have those resources. We need, within the primary healthcare system, to start allocating responsibilities on certain aspects of diabetes management to other health professionals, pharmacists, credentialed diabetes educators, dietitians. You can't fight the war as an individual. You actually need a team and a force to do so. And I think that, but one of the most important things is that the government, to get the message across that diabetes care isn't a simple thing. Now, I know I haven't given any good advice as to how we're going to go about this, but for sure, unless this is recognised, and the fact that diabetes is now probably the largest epidemic facing any community, it's bigger than cholera, it's bigger than anything we've seen in the past, and unless we get the message across, and then it gets translated right down the system, and we're going to still have people, you know, having complications and whatnot. We actually, Jeff has mentioned, there's a new drug class just come out that actually not only is good for lowering the blood sugar, it reduces blood pressure, it reduces risk of heart disease, it reduces risk of kidney disease. Now, maybe we've got some hope now in the management of type 2 diabetes behind those 11 drugs, but who's going to pay for it? So I know it's a very negative comment I've got, but I think it's a good place to start.
Yeah.
And sorry, I think jumping into the point that you made about who's going to pay for it, I'm a medical social worker, so I work with a lot of the with certain groups, especially the vulnerable groups and the low-income populations. And I think over the past 10 years when I've been working, you find that at the end of the day, it's easier to get funding for chemotherapy treatment than it is to get funding for test strips for diabetic patients. I think in the past 5 years as well, the Diabetic Society of Singapore actually for a period of time had to close down their services, and we can't put in new applications for funding because they just said, I don't have any more funding. And when they restarted operations again, they actually restricted, they make it more difficult for patients to actually apply and say, only the really low-income people can get it. Whereas I think then you get more funding, obviously places like National Kidney Foundation or Cancer Singapore Cancer Society, I mean, they continue to have, you know, very good fundraising kind of outcomes. And I think this, so I think the monetary part is a big problem. Whenever we introduce new treatments, these are often expensive, which then the majority of Singaporeans aren't very willing to actually pay for it. For example, if I've got two patients, a patient waiting for, say, financial assistance for chemotherapy, they will call me every day asking, what's the outcome? But for a diabetic patient, if they don't get the funding, they just leave it and they forget about it, and you don't hear from them ever again, because to them, they think it's just not as important. And I think a particular patient who had diabetes once shared with me, when we tried to persuade him to actually go for specialist follow-up, such as appointments with the nephrologist and the ophthalmologist, and he said, look, I know that you care about us and you want to take care of us, but he said that the majority of the people like me don't want to be healthy. We just don't want to fall sick so often. Being in perfect health isn't my priority, you know, at this point in time, which is a difficult problem. And I think I'm quite happy to actually hear about some of the efforts that are being done, both from the government and from the ground up, about tackling this issue. But I think at the end of the day, when it comes to prioritization, the general public at this point in time, at least from what I can see, it doesn't seem like, unless there's a very strong monetary incentive or a very strong approach to tackle financial barriers, tackling this idea of like chronic disease and preventive health will never be a priority compared to more and more serious and life-threatening issues as we see it, such as cancer and all that.
Right, thanks. I think time is catching up. We have to round up. Maybe just some last words from the panelists.
I'd like to end on a more optimistic note. So perhaps, Kenneth, you look like you want to say something. So perhaps
you're assuming that I will say the negative so that you can say the positive. Okay, actually, I'm going to say something positive as well. We actually are working on several pieces, and collectively, I think these pieces will help to move the issues in the areas that you've all identified as gaps as well. We have to recognize that still, at this point in time, the majority of patients with chronic disease are still being looked after by family physicians in our polyclinics. And through our polyclinics, we actually are working on several initiatives, including more funding that actually is flowing down. There will be more support also for the chronic disease management programs. On the GP front, we're also trying to look at the financial gradients to ensure that the gradients are appropriately managed. We do want to move patients away when they do not need specialist care, to move them back into the community. And as part of that journey to move them back into the community, we're also looking at how best to do this. But it probably will be in the setting of chronic disease management programs, which will also be funded. And we are looking also at the issue of accessibility to drugs and medications. There is a need, however, to have some sense of rational thought behind what medications are appropriate for patients, and appropriate care guidelines are what we're also looking at to better empower our primary physicians to therefore understand what are the medications that in fact are best applicable to the patients that they have. It's also important to empower our primary physicians in many different ways. While we talked about the majority of patients being seen in our polyclinics, we still have a significant number of our patients being seen by GPs, and some of our GPs still remain in singleton practice. We do need to see how we can better empower these people, and ideally we're hoping to also run and implement different GP models in the community that will now overcome these disadvantages that are intrinsic in solo practices, singleton practices on the ground, through networks that will form, whether as part of a primary care network or, in fact, aggregating some of our family physicians to work within better resourced setups like family medicine centres, where, in fact, we can also bring more resources in to help to empower the GPs, particularly in the areas of screening for complications, whether diabetic retinopathy screening, foot screening, and otherwise. We also want to work on the various other pieces that look at the outcomes and information awareness, because we do understand that patients may hop and they will transit across care settings between primary care, hospital, primary care. We want to increase the visibility that the primary physicians have of their patients' journeys. And it's not just how the patients are moving, but the results of tests done in the hospital, strategies that work through with a specialist coming down into the back when the patient returns back into primary care. We want to better empower the GPs to know what is going on for their patients. A lot of work is taking place behind the scenes through the National Electronic Health Record, but it also is not just on the hardware side of the house. It also is building up alliances and relationships between the specialist and the family physician. And an example is here in the campus next door in NUHS, where they have got, in fact, a very good working relationship now with endocrinologists and family physicians, particularly working in their family medicine center in Clementi. So these are roadmaps for us to scale up and roll out through the rest of the island. And we can do so, our family physicians will be better empowered. The current state is only a transitory state. It's an ongoing journey, and I'm quite confident that the future family physician will be better empowered to manage diabetes.
Okay, Swee.
I just wanted to quickly address what Jeff and Paul mentioned about the complexity and the multiple drugs. Whilst that's true, I would also argue that we certainly don't need all over 50 medications, and we certainly don't need all these different insulins. So just to give you a very specific example, basal insulin alone, which is your background insulin, we have Dedamir, Lantus, Glargine, Levemir, and so on, but you only need one out of the ever so many, right? So whilst it can seem complex, I would also posit that perhaps sometimes we like to make things seem more complex than they need to be, perhaps to, I don't know, to give us a sense of self-importance. I don't buy any of that. And I think that we should just try and break down the problem and then tackle pieces that, you know, yes, there's a whole lot of things that we don't know, but can we just work with the things that we do know and do something positive about that? In that regard, I just wanted to wrap up on two things. We mentioned about what we know or don't know about the burden of diabetes. And yes, genetics, epigenetics definitely play an important role. I think the other thing that we mustn't forget is that what we're seeing now with the huge burden is not just a reflection of genetics, epigenetics, and the thrifty gene hypothesis, famine and all that. But don't forget, I think on the ground, I see that there is this characteristic of resilience. You have a generation who've lived through the war, and that's affected them in profound ways towards their attitude towards self-care and towards healthcare needs. If I've survived the war, what's a little bit of diabetes? I don't think I need to take that too seriously. So there are all these different mindsets that we have to work with as well. Secondly, with regards to interventions, yes, interventions like the DPP is expensive. They've been proven to work. It involves 150 minutes, physiotherapists, nutritionists, a whole SWAT team, a whole army. But I would argue that DPP was done in an era where we don't have apps, we don't have technology. I'm not saying that technology and apps will work for everyone. But let's then work in today's environment and ask, perhaps in a generation that don't work with apps, we find a solution that works better for them. In the generation that's coming up now, who are familiar with technology, are there more scalable, cost-effective ways to deliver the education and empower them with the knowledge, understanding they need? Knowledge and understanding is one, doing something about it is another. And I think that from a patient's perspective, scaring them with amputations and bad things that can happen to you when you don't look after your diabetes works in the very, very for the very, very short term. Nobody is going to say, oh, instead of eating nasi lemak, I'm going to eat oats because I'm scared my leg is going to be amputated. That only works for a very short time. It's really the positive feedback, how they are feeling after they're eating healthier and being more active. When they come back and they look at numbers and they actually see how the numbers are changing and what difference it makes, and they get some positive reinforcement, whether it's through an app, through a provider, through a call. I think these are all various ways that we can explore how to do things in a more scalable, cost-effective manner. So I'd just like to end with a note of hope. And yes, today is World Diabetes Day, and even insulin, which so many people seem to fear, I'll say that, look, today they don't come in bottles and big needles. They come in swanky pens. They are insulins that basically, the goal of insulin therapy is to replace what your body normally makes. In the past, we only had two types of insulin that nowhere resembled the normal physiological patterns of insulin secretion that your body would normally make. Now we do. So our job then as care providers is to figure out what works and equip our patients with this to be able to move forward and embrace diabetes so that it's not suffering, but it's something that they can live with and live well with. And I'd say that it is possible. I think I saw some of our nurses in the audience when they were walking in earlier. Are you all still here, the APNs? Yes, see, they're all there, right? They are nurses, and they do this too. And in recent years, they've learned this, and they're actually able to do it. So say that, yes, it's complex to an extent, but I think there are things we can know. Let's take charge of the things that we do know.
Well, thank you very much. I hate to leave a negative note here, but I come back to the war on diabetes. Someone has to get the message through to public health people and to governments the impact of diabetes. Diabetes is a hell of a problem. It's for people at a society level, it's a very difficult situation. But actually for a nation, Singapore has got a prevalence of diabetes twice that in Australia. So you're a country which really is facing a major burden of diabetes. People with type 2 diabetes, type 1's expensive. People with type 2 diabetes, about 30 to 40% from studies are depressed. There's a 30 to 40% association with obstructive sleep apnea. People with type 2 diabetes poorly managed get fatty liver, and it's said that the commonest cause of cirrhosis over the next few decades will not be alcohol, but diabetes and obesity. It's a very expensive disorder. It affects the community in many ways. Truck drivers in Australia go to sleep, you know, they've got diabetes, they go to sleep at the wheel and they crash into trains, simple road accidents, etc. We've got to look at diabetes actually not just as a problem of elevated blood glucose. Now, all that being said, I actually congratulate Singapore. There's a very large public awareness of diabetes. You've got to start somewhere. You've got to have leadership. Hopefully, you've got that from the government. You've got to have information. You've got very good documentation of the magnitude of the problem in Singapore and the numbers. Financing's another question, but Singapore seems to be able to find plenty of money for technology centres and such like. You need to have the partnerships, of course, the private sector, the government sector, etc. And you've got to have a good workforce, and you've got a good workforce. It's just not big enough. You need a bigger workforce for diabetes. And it's a prescribed community. Someone said it's the largest island in the world. Obviously, it isn't exactly so, but the opportunity here in Singapore. And one thing Singapore is very well known for is its information technology, and the technology side could be much better utilised. I've discussed it with Rob Van Dam and some of his colleagues here in terms of prevention. We haven't succeeded at a community level in convincing people to change their behaviours for losing weight and exercising more, but perhaps with the use of modern social media, et cetera, there are different ways to look at the problem. And I think that's something you could do here in Singapore.
Well, my take home from today's session is that, Paul says that diabetes is very complicated, but I think it's more than complicated, it's so complex. And that if we want to look at this as a problem, tackling it as a problem in Singapore, we mustn't oversimplify it. I think one, as academics, we tend to have a reductionist kind of mentality, and we tend to try to simplify things. I think one is we need to accept that it is highly complex. The interventions will then have to be actually highly complex. Yes, we tend to break it down into pieces, and we therefore tackle the pieces. But let's not forget that the pieces would have interactions with each other, and it's kind of like a domino effect. There will be knock-on effects, and there will be a lot of unwanted consequences And I think we need to really look at it from that kind of perspective rather than say, I have a complex problem and break down into simple parts and then I just distribute out the different parts and let different parts deal with it. So a lot of that kind of complex system approach needs to be actually built into it. My concern is, of course, that the biomedical community wants to simplify. The public wants a simple message. The politicians also want a simple solution. But we need to highlight that actually we need to think through and work through some of this. And that just takes time. You know, that just takes time. That just takes a lot of engagement, a lot of input from different groups. And that's painful and that just takes time. So you know, maybe that's not a very uplifting message. But if we really want to win this war, we really want to tackle this, we have to take on that mindset. Then I think we did manage to cover a lot of the topics that we wanted to cover this morning. What I'll be doing is I'll send this out to all of you and to those who have registered who hasn't attended. And we would love to get your feedback. And then we will also compile it together as part of the report that will put it up to Ministry of Health. So don't worry if you find that you didn't have a chance to make a suggestion or give your comments and so forth. We can do it via email. Let me just now invite the panel members back to their seats, and I'll just go on to the last part of the program before we go break for lunch. I think I introduced Paul as a mover and a shaker in the world of diabetes. And I thought we want to give him a special gift today, you know, since he's the emperor of the third largest nation. You know. So what we did was we actually commissioned an artist. We gave the artist a photograph of Paul. I think that must be a picture of Paul in his younger days. I'm sure Vivian, your wife, will approve of this caricature. At the same time, we gave her his entire CV and says, you know, try and graphically, illustrate it. She came back, she gave up. She said, too long. I will need a poster 3 times the size. And I'll charge you more. Me, you know, being very cheapskate, I said, fine, don't put the whole CV. Just put a part of it. You know? So you only have a part of your CV in this whole poster. Well, when he was a young endocrinologist, he was captivated by a journal article about the high prevalence of diabetes in the Pacific Islands. So he took a 7-hour flight from Melbourne to Nauru. And on his first day of field work, he tested 100 patients, or 100 residents, and found 1/3 of them suffered from diabetes. So that started him on a trail of studying diabetes, especially among the island communities. And today he is widely known to be recognized for his studies in Mauritius and also the Pacific Ocean populations. And he sounded the alarm on the global diabetes epidemic way back then, you know, about westernization and the impact on diabetes. So in 1978, he attended the historic Kroc Foundation conference where they discussed on the classification and debated on the diagnostic criteria, appropriate methodology for epi study into diabetes. And that led on to WHO holding the expert committee on the meeting on diabetes. And you heard earlier he mentioned about his contribution to Australia, the largest diabetes and obesity study in Australia. And then he led and chaired, co-chaired the National Diabetes Strategy Group, which developed the Australian National Diabetes Strategy. Now, how did he get, you know, to start in touch with Singapore? So it was in 2010. I was not in diabetes, you know, I was in cancer, you know. And I just started working on diabetes, and I had my colleague Salome, who was working with me as my postdoc, and we're looking at diabetes burden in the world. We look at the World Diabetes Atlas, which the IDF came up with, and Paul was one of the key person behind that project. And we questioned his methodology. And so Salome says, why don't you email him and ask him? I was thinking, you know, I'm not known in this world of diabetes. This is a big shot. If I email him, he won't reply. So I did what the next best thing. I said, Salome, you email him. She did. And he replied. So that started the working relationship that we had with Paul, and we work on the paper, you know, Turning the Tide, Prevention of Diabetes in Asia. So over the last 6 years, we became very close friends, and I'm very happy that he was able to work very closely with us, and is now contributing to Singapore War on Diabetes. So to present this gift to Paul, I've asked Salome to be the one to give this. And don't worry, we'll ship it back to you.
That was indeed a very intense panel discussion. And with that, we have come to the end of today's session. Once again, we would like to thank our panelists, Associate Professor Kenneth Ma, Dr. Suan To, and Professor Paul Zimmet, Professor Chia Kee Seng as well, for their insights on Singapore's war on diabetes. I hope that everyone has enjoyed and gained much from today's panel discussion. And just a reminder, before we proceed for lunch, you can either scan a QR code or follow this URL to download the paper that Professor Chia mentioned earlier. Lunch is served at the foyer outside the Clinical Research Center's auditorium, and our ushers will help you direct your way to the lunch venue.